Good morning. I had to check my watch just to make sure it is morning. I'm still on Chicago time, so I'm trying to make it work. First, I'd really like to say thank you for having me here and to believe that I have something to offer this effort. It's difficult for me as just a guy from 47th Street in Chicago when groups from around the country ask you to share some of your experiences. As my sister said, my name is Jitu Brown. I'm the National Director of the Journey for Justice Alliance. We are a network of grassroots community-based organizations unapologetically led by black and brown people in 24 cities and two countries. So we do have membership in Johannesburg. I'm so excited about that. And we are trying to build grassroots power in these cities. This conversation that I'd like to have today, I don't want to talk too long. I want to leave some time for us to engage with each other around, you know, equity in public education, I think is a real critical question. When you look at education in the United States or in the world, the United States ranks 19th amongst developed countries. But when you take out poverty, where does the U.S. rank? 2. So we know how to educate children. We've just made a conscious decision not to educate children from particular communities. And one of the biggest issues is that we've become masterful at blaming those communities for being underserved. So my conversation today, I want folks to know that none of what I'm gonna say is personal. But before I go, because I'm 50 now, so I see the brother in the audience who said, I mean, you still kind of cock diesel. I said, yeah, well, the last thing to go is your strength. But what went a long time ago is the speed. So I'm gonna do this. Everybody raise your right hand and say, I say your name. Do solemnly swear to have an open mind, to listen with a humble spirit, and not chase G2 down the street at the end of the presentation. All right. Did everybody say it? Make sure that everybody said it, right? All right. My 40-yard dash is probably like 10-5 now, so that's over with. You know, I often think about my journey to become a community organizer. When I was a kid, I just knew, even though sister broke my heart talking about my Bears, I just knew, because I idolized Richard Dent, and I just knew that I would be the next defensive end for the Chicago Bears. And I was pretty good. I played in high school, played in college, got hurt in college and soldiered through, and I got a tryout with the Green Bay Packers. Believe it or not, the Green Bay Packers. And I found out about a week into camp that my NFL dream was not going to work. And I realized that I had gone about as far as I can go. I was in the music industry. And believe it or not, I was an MC. And I was on Polygram Records. And used to tour a little bit with Public Enemy and X-Clan. And, you know, and I did a visit to an elementary school in Chicago. It was a promotional tour. And I'm talking to the young people, and a young man, his school was called Shakespeare. Now it's Ariel Academy, but it was Shakespeare at the time. And the young man was slumped in his chair, and he basically looked at me and said, hey, man, you talking all this good stuff, man, but you ain't coming back, though. And something, you all know, like, often we get messages kind of how we should be going towards our higher self every day. We get those signals, and we ignore them. And for whatever reason, the creator made sure I heard that. And I had an opportunity to leave Smash Polygram and go to MCA Records, and I was confronted with a decision. I also had an opportunity to start volunteering at a little community organization across the street from my house called the Kenwood Oakland Community Organization, better known as COCO. And I made the right decision, which is I left the music industry and I started volunteering with youth programs in about 5 elementary schools, and that began my journey. While community organizing is not a lucrative field, right, one thing that I'm very proud of, and I talk to my wife about this, is to wake up knowing why you wake up every morning, knowing when you wake up with a sense of purpose, and that you're working towards a particular goal is liberating and it's energizing. And so I've been an organizer for about 25 years. I've won some and lost some. And we formed the Journey for Justice Alliance in 2012 because organizers were calling me around the country saying, I feel isolated. I feel by myself. They're saying our schools are failing. Our schools aren't failing. We've been failed, right? And we all got on the phone and started talking about equity issues and the things that we see in our neighborhood, the things we see in other neighborhoods that we don't see in our neighborhood, and nobody's addressing this. It's like the narrative that there's something wrong with black and brown children, people were grabbing and running with it, making money off of it, right? And so we made a conscious decision to start organizing around that. Now, I want to be very clear, I'm not an activist. I think activists are beautiful, we need activists. Activists are individuals that raise issues. They choose the issues that they raise. Organizers are people movers. Organizers, in the world, we know there are two types of power. It's people power and money power. And in America, we've forgotten the artistic science of community organizing. We've forgotten how to move people. We've become, to some degree, an unconscious constituency, where we've allowed this inhumane treatment of human beings to go unchecked. And in the black community around the country, we did do community organizing. How many people in this room, how many women in this room voted? All right. How many people in this room of color have ever flown on an airplane? Gone to a college campus? Went to a Walgreens? Understand that in my lifetime, many of those things were not possible. In my lifetime, not 100 years ago, not 200 years ago, when you see young people sitting at the lunch counter at Woolworths, that was the 1950s version of Walgreens, where we did not have the right to go into that space and be treated like human beings. And as a direct result of community organizing, we're able to do the things we're able to do today. We're able to sit at a conference and talk about social justice. There was a time in this country where these conversations would get you killed. These conversations would get you hunted down. And we've forgotten that as a country. We've become very comfortable while people who claim to be progressives basically sell us out with our consent. So in the Journey for Justice Alliance, we decided to, in these particular cities where there were grassroots community-based organizations ran by the people directly impacted, how can we build our power to start winning the types of schools that we envision for our children? So before I go any further, I want to say, you know, I want to talk a little bit about what education is. When you ask people what is education, they'll say, well, it's where you learn the skills and the talents to be able to compete in today's society. And why don't some folks tell me, if I asked you what is education, what would you say? Anybody? To build citizens. Expand the mind. Teach. All right. Speak louder now. To explore. To empower. Those are great. Those are good. I want to share with you what we say. We say that education is inspiration and information that prepare young people to make their way in the world, to prepare young people to impact the world. But that education is not about the information that you force feed to a child. How many classroom teachers we have in this room? So is the teachable moment the moment when a child memorizes information you give them, or is it when that child realizes that they can? What's the teachable moment? When a child has that moment of self-discovery where their own limitations have been lifted, that's inspiration. Inspiration is when a child that curses all the time, right? And you're talking with that child and you're working with that child patiently, and all of a sudden, Mark comes to class and he doesn't curse. He said, why aren't you cursing? He said, you told me not to curse. That is a teachable moment. That is a moment of inspiration. That is a moment when that child's possibilities have been lifted. But we live in a system where, in particular communities, the opportunities for inspiration are eliminated. We say Johnny goes to a failing school. This failing school does not reap these test scores. These are the punitive actions we're going to put on it. Then the school responds. The school says, okay, so we have to get rid of creative writing. We have to get rid of drama. And from 9 to 11:30, we'll have reading block. Am I telling the truth? 9 to 11:30, we'll have reading block. There'll be no world language because they have to have math drill. And then we wonder why the children are in school and the light goes out. We wonder why the children are in these classrooms and they're not inspired. And that policy is not implemented in communities that are not of color. That policy is not. So what happens is that now these schools are labeled failing, but we haven't even addressed the 1,600-pound elephant in the room. The 1,600-pound elephant in the room is that the reason why education does not work in the United States is because public education was never intended for people of color. Public education was never intended for America's former slaves. It was never intended for Latino families. It was never intended for Native Americans. As a matter of fact, we know that the Christian schools in this country used to attack and sometimes kill Native American children if they would not cut their hair or change their names. We believe that that's a thing of the past. We believe, well, that was the old America. That's not America today. So, how many of you all, so I'm gonna raise it like this. A great hero in the United States history is a woman by the name of Ida B. Wells. Ida B. Wells was born in Mississippi. She was a journalist. She wrote a book called The Red Record, chronicling the lynching of black people in the United States. She even had a crew that used to go and try to save men from being lynched, where she would carry a pistol on each hip, and they would go and try to stop men and women and children from being lynched. They bombed, white people in Mississippi bombed her printing press, her printing location. She fled to Chicago into the Bronzeville community. And one of her efforts was to try to get anti-lynching laws enacted in the United States. Woodrow Wilson would not sign the anti-lynching legislation. He showed Birth of a Nation at the White House. So what I want to raise, brothers and sisters in this room, I'm going to ask you to do this for me. Assume that you're racist. Assume it. Racism is not about an intent. Racism is a belief system, a value system, beliefs that govern your behavior. Racism is a belief system that has infected every aspect of American life. There's no escape from it. There's not an intellectual piece. It is ingrained in the DNA of the United States. I want to share this with you. So the value system that led Woodrow Wilson to not sign the anti-lynching law, the value system that led him to show The Birth of a Nation, a movie that had black people in Congress eating watermelon and chasing white women, and promoted the Ku Klux Klan as a historic organization and sparked the increase of lynchings in the United States, was shown at the White House. That belief system is the same belief system that made this country say that something was wrong with Eric Garner and somehow he deserved to be lynched on YouTube. We all watched Eric Garner, a granddaddy, a papa, say, man, please leave me alone, please. And we saw a gang of police officers choke him out on YouTube and we digested it, all of us did. So for every person in this room, assume that you're racist. For every person of color in this room, assume that you suffer from internalized racism. None of us are immune to it. That same belief system tried to demonize Oscar Grant in Oakland when basically he was wet up at a police station, at a train station. That same belief system tried to criminalize Tamir Rice, a 12-year-old who actually got a drive-by done on him in Cleveland. That same belief system validated the closing of 50 schools in Chicago in one fell swoop. Now 15-year-olds are standing on bus stops in other neighborhoods and they're not coming home. If you think the murder rate in Chicago, Illinois is not connected to the destruction of communities in Chicago, then I got a bridge I want to sell you. If you believe that somehow these conditions that happen in Baltimore, Detroit, Chicago, Philadelphia, Oakland, New Orleans is somehow connected to the individual personal responsibility of those individuals, that is the comfortable, cowardly space that we like to hide behind. Because the real question is, why has America never reconciled its hatred for black people? Its hatred is deep, vicious, psychopathic hatred of a particular people just because of who God made them. And the proof is in the pudding. I don't want to be tolerated by anybody in this room. I can mind my own business. But what we seek is real brotherhood and sisterhood. And in the progressive movement, how many people here consider themselves progressives? You can raise your hand, all right? All right. You see, Donald Trump got us not even want to say we progress. Let's try that again. How many people in this room would say that you're progressive? Okay. Now please hear me. In this country, one of the biggest weaknesses of the progressive movement is a refusal to face its own racism. And so what happens, and I've been in 1,000 coalitions, about 895 of them I wish I was never in, but I've been in about 1,000 coalitions. What we must do in order to exist in those coalitions is shrink. We cannot bring our experiences to the table. We cannot come. I've had organizers, white organizers, with a group of black people in the room tell them, don't talk about race, because people won't hear you. And so that type of organizing has resulted in Donald Trump being president of the United States. Because the needs of people in neighborhoods like Oakland, Detroit, see, on the south side of Chicago, my lived experience has been with people who don't have a pot to pee in and the window to throw it out of, but are moral, upstanding, devoted people. You'll see in a minute, I was part, and I'm proud that we did it, but I'm ashamed of this country that it took what we had to do. We waged a 34-day hunger strike to stop the closing of our last open enrollment neighborhood high school. And on the 25th day of our hunger strike, the mayor of Chicago, Rahm Emanuel, did a ribbon cutting at Lincoln Elementary, a wealthy school two blocks from DePaul University, a $21 million annex, while we starved in Washington Park. So there's an old African proverb that says, the truth is simple, if it's complicated, it's a lie. So you can tell me that that's not about race, but one thing I'm not is stupid. It's definitely that children on one side of town are valued more than children on the other side of town. And if we're not prepared to face that, then we will never heal what's wrong with the quality of life in America. We will never heal the fact that we have the largest number of people incarcerated on the planet Earth. More than apartheid-era South Africa. I witnessed the result of so-called progressive policy, when Bill Clinton signed the crime bill, I was a young organizer, and we were at Northeastern Illinois University, and I saw two school buses driving to Ida B. Wells housing projects and take two school buses full of 14 to 18-year-olds to jail. And that happens all over the United States. All you have to do is ride a Greyhound, and you go to some obscure city, and here comes a brother or a Latino brother with some khakis and a white t-shirt and a box. And there's nothing in that town but that prison. But everybody in that city eats off that prison. And so what I'm saying to you is not some type of militant rant, because really I'm not a militant dude, is really about an honest analysis about what we are facing in this country. So I want to share something with you. I want to share a course comparison that we did in Chicago. So if you don't mind putting that up for me, the course comparison. So can you all see that? Yeah? Okay. So Dyett High School is a historic high school on the south side of Chicago. Captain Walter Dyett was called the Star Maker. He was a music teacher at Phillips High School and eventually at DuSable High School. His students included Nat King Cole, Eddie Harris, Red Fox, Dinah Washington. A lot of these people, and a lot of people that became giants in jazz music were his students. He died in 1969. Dyett High School was erected as a middle school in 1972. It was one of the more popular middle schools on the south side of Chicago. As the Bronzeville community was gentrifying, in 1999, King High School, which was a neighborhood high school, was transformed into a college prep. With 3 months' notice, the local school council was told that Dyett would become a high school. So I joined the local school council at Dyett in 2003. In Chicago, we have local governing bodies at every school called local school councils. We hire the principal, we approve the budget, we monitor the principal, we help develop the school improvement plan, and if need be, we can actually remove the principal, right? So when I joined the local school council at Dyett, that means the first graduating class was preparing to leave, and there were no honors classes. So these children didn't even have the option of an honors class, let alone advanced placement. So we began to do the work to improve the school. So despite the fact that Dyett was a receiving school for another high school closing, are y'all following me or am I like in the weeds? Are we cool? All right, cool. I know that's a local piece, all right. So in 2008, we had the largest increase of students going to college in the entire city of Chicago. We hired an excellent principal, a sister named Jacqueline Lemon. We brought community organizations in. We instituted restorative justice as a school-wide policy. The Dyett students were national models. They went all over the country training people on restorative justice. We had the largest increase of students going to college and the largest decrease in arrests and suspensions for two straight years. In 2011, we won the ESPN Rise Up Award, which means we beat out maybe 600 other schools around the country, got a $4 million renovation to our school, and the next year they voted to phase the school out. So, fortunately, and the vote was approved in 2012, but we had begun to work to talk about the inequity of that, because by the time they phased it out, all the initiatives that we put in place, they cut. So what we did is we did a course comparison between Northside College Prep, which is a college preparatory school that many white families send their children to, Lakeview High School, a neighborhood high school two blocks from Mayor Rahm Emanuel's house with about 30% white enrollment, and Dyett High School. So you see AP classes, Northside College Prep has 22, Lakeview had 12, Dyett had what?
Zero.
You see science, you can see the options availed to people at Northside College Prep, the options availed to folks at Lakeview, and the options afforded to folks at Dyett. But let's go to art. You see what's available to people at Northside College Prep. You see what's happening at Lakeview. And what's that first line for Dyett? So Dyett students were taking art as an online class. Now, we laugh about, and it got worse. The next year, in 2014 and 15, they had to take gym as an online class. Now, thankfully, the students at Dyett were organizers, and 34 of them filed Title VI civil rights complaints with the U.S. Department of Education Office of Civil Rights, which began the students at Dyett started the fight for Dyett. Cassandra Neal and Diamond McCullough came into my office. They said, what are we going to do about my school? I told them, okay, call a meeting. I thought it would be 20 young people, about 65 young people in the room. And they cared about their school. They were saying, what they're saying about us is not true. We are not a failing school. We've been failed. So that messaging came from young people. See, as a parent, when you kiss your child, you, and they have their backpack on and they go to school, you have the right. I don't care what color you are, whether you are wealthy, or whether your annual median income is $10,000. You have a right to expect that the system that you pay taxes to provides for your child a high quality of education within safe walking distance of your home. Every American deserves that. Would you agree? Would you agree? Okay. So, when we say, we have to ask the honest question, why isn't it happening? So, what the young people at Dyett did is they began to lift up the contradictions, the fact that no, we had all these achievements, and what you're doing is you're closing the school because you want the school, because you're gentrifying the area, because people want the Obama Library right there in the middle of Washington Park. And so what we began to do is a community-based process of saying, what does the community want to see? And our vision, when we had a design team that included students, parents, and educators, and we came up with the vision and the plan for Dyett Global Leadership and Green Technology High School as the hub of a sustainable community school village. So it wasn't just Dyett, it was Dyett and six of his feeder schools. We engaged the parents, so we had a critical mass of people. We began to bring those people to the school board. We began to chase Rahm Emanuel down the street. So when Rahm Emanuel do a press conference, here comes 50 young people holding a big sign in the press conference saying, save Dyett, and asking him, what about Dyett High School? So we caught him at a school called Bret Hart, and he agreed to reopen the school. That was a major victory. But then he said in the news that it might be a charter. So we had to escalate. So long story short, despite the fact we had a world-class plan, education experts had said it was one of the best education plans they had ever seen, despite the fact we had mass community support, we had 600 people in the neighborhood mail letters to the mayor, we had over 4,000 petition signatures, we held town hall meetings, the smallest turnout was 250, so we demonstrated that the people wanted this school. Their decision was still to try to make it a charter school or a contract school. And our point was, why do we need profiteers or people making money off of black and brown children running schools? Now, I want to be clear with you all. I am not an anti-charter school ideologue. I'm not somebody, you know, breathing fire over charter schools. But I am somebody who is against the charter industry. And everybody in this room should be against the charter industry. Because if charters as a whole were so great, here's a simple question. Why don't white folks have them? If they're so great, why are they highly racialized? See, we're doing everything but equity. We're doing everything but I'm in full support. Like, there's a charter in Chicago that focuses on robotics, and the community chose it. But they have good elementary schools. It's in the Chatham community in Chicago. And they have a decent high school, Simeon, and they wanted a school that focused on robotics and science, and the community supported. I don't have a problem with that. But what we don't have in the progressive movement is a respect for black people's and brown people's right for self-determination. See, nobody comes into white neighborhoods and says, we're gonna close your schools, and it's gonna be ran by this company, and no matter how many people protest, we're gonna do it anyway. See, they tried to, in several cities around the country, they've tried to bring charters in the middle-class white communities, and when the middle-class white brothers and sisters said no, the charter said okay. When we say no, they say, well, your schools are failing. Unless we're honest about that, then there is no changing of the American education system, because what we're doing is we're going with what's comfortable, what makes us feel comfortable. I'm not here to make anybody in this room feel comfortable. I'm not, and what I'm saying to you is not personal. What I'm saying to you is I have a 7-year-old, a young black boy in the United States of America in a city where his life is in peril. I've worked with young people, I've buried young people. That's a part of my life that you're looking at a man that is not a minister, but I have officiated funerals. Nothing is worse than touching the body of a child that you helped raise. And they're gone. And you knew that they did not deserve where they are. But we live in a country where black death is acceptable. It's acceptable. It is acceptable. It's acceptable to have a system that funnels, that heaps, maybe the right word is, inflicts zero tolerance on black and brown children, inflicts it upon them. And so how many, just think about this. How many children's lives have been ruined because of zero tolerance? All they needed was somebody like my brother Ronnie Thomas from South Shore High School, had a mother who was on drugs, grandmother who was drinking because she's tired, and she don't have time to raise three children, a 13-year-old boy who's slipping, and Ronnie's 15, so he walks his brother to school every day, and he gets to South Shore late every day. But instead of a counselor, he got a write-up. How many of y'all can relate to that story? So when will we own the fact that we view black and brown children through a lens, and as black people, those of us that have $5 in our pocket, we've adopted it. We've adopted a perception of our people grounded in white supremacy, grounded in it, so that our young people are products. You know, I have a checkered background, but I'll just say that, and I'll say that in the drug game, drugs are called work or merch. And however many drugs you have, you call that your work. And so however much you step on it, or whatever, that allows you to make more money. In this system, black and brown children are work for a system that makes a system that makes trillions of dollars off their incarceration and off their death. And until we're ready to face that, we're not ready to talk about changing the system. Because when somebody said, well, what do you want for education? I say to my white brother, I want what you got. I want my child to have world language. I want my child to have smaller class sizes. I want a teacher aide in the room with the teacher. I want my child to learn his history and culture. I want my child to have the opportunities for inspiration. Where are the debate teams? Where's the robotics clubs? Where's the Afro-American History Club? Why can't my child go to Spain? Why can't my child go to South Africa? But when you look at urban schools, our children don't have those experiences, and that is just the truth. That's the truth. It's not my opinion. It's what we have seen in urban districts all over this country. They are closing schools in Eupora, Mississippi. It's towns that have two restaurants in them. The whole city, they're closing schools, and they're sending black children 30 miles away to a neighboring school district, but they won't send them to the white school district, where those schools are pristine. They look great. They send these children to another bombed out school district. So even though they pay taxes, they don't have the right to control the education in their community. So I kind of went on a rant there. I apologize. We all good? All right. And the reason I'm talking to you guys like this is because I work in coalition with brown, or with Mexican brothers and sisters, with Puerto Rican brothers and sisters, and with white brothers and sisters. And but our coalitions are grounded in the needs of those that have the least, which the progressive movement needs to get to understand. That we should not have to marginalize ourselves to come to the table with you. We should not have to be able to speak our reality in order to come to the table with you. And if we have a unilateral commitment to the end of racism in this country, if you won't digest it, if you projectile vomit it when it comes your way, or when you see it, then we'll begin to see change. But we have to be honest about the fact that we've become accustomed to it. We've accepted it. So I want to share a quick video clip with you about a major organizing victory in Chicago. We fought one of the more powerful Democrats in the United States. I think you all are able to tweet and get the whole video. We're just going to show a clip. So, the fight for Dyett. So Walter Dyett was known as the star maker in Bronzeville, who was a brilliant music instructor.
So in 1972, Dyett Middle School was built in his honor. But in 1999, as this community, Bronzeville, was gentrifying, Martin Luther King High School was transformed into Martin Luther King College Prep. Children that lived across the street from King could no longer go. The Chicago Public Schools, with 3 months' notice, told the local school council at Dyett that they would start accepting freshmen, as there were no honors or AP classes. So Dyett never had the support to be a functional high school that really met the needs of children in the neighborhood. We had to fight for everything that we got.
I just feel like it's unfair to me and all my classmates and everybody else in my community.
With the same year that Dyett was turned to a high school, the same year that King College Prep was turned to Select Enrollment High School, and they received $25 million, while Dyett received little to no resources.
These are the young people that launched the fight for Dyett.
A lot of resources at Dyett have been taken
away.
That's
Cassandra Neal.
I've been at Dyett for 4 years.
She goes to Philander Smith University now.
And I've seen a lot of after school programs, teachers, classes, and stuff like that taken away.
And then they start pushing towards zero tolerance a lot. And that started to force young people to get kicked out of Dyett, and young people to leave, you know, just because of the hard discipline policies.
So young people at Dyett began to work to change the culture of the school themselves.
They had this freshman connection program where you would be able to meet with seniors in the school and you would be able to talk to the principal and you got guys going on trips.
In 2008, we had the largest increase of students going to college in CPS. We had the largest decrease in arrests and suspensions. We had a nationally recognized restorative justice program. And you saw the climate in the school begin to change. And a lot of good things started to happen. Because Dyett was never given the support from the district to be a successful school. This was a community-driven effort to improve this school. And in 2011, we won the ESPN Rise Up Award.
Dyett High School is a good school. The kids here are good kids. But due to our inadequate funding, it's hard for us to run our athletic teams.
It's my pleasure to announce officially that Rise Up is coming to Dyett High School.
We beat out over 500 schools around the country as a small school that was doing great things but needed help.
It provided over like $4 million for our school, so it like revamped the gymnasium.
We got a complete renovation of our athletic facilities, college level weight room, a brand new gymnasium, equipment and everything like that. And then the next year they phased the school out.
I remember like 2011, they came out with this like paper that was saying that Dyett High School was going to possibly be voted to phase out in like in December. And it was saying that the school was underperforming and we was just standing up there. And I remember like the board just saying that they voted anonymously to close and phase out Dyett High School. And I can remember the like the crowd, you know, just being in shock. Like we all came up here and we expressed like how devastating this is for the community, and they just decided to close our schools without even listening to us. So I felt really bad. I just knew I wasn't valued, and at that time I was just very discouraged. I just really believed like, oh, I can't go to college. Like, you know, I'm not college material.
So, you all have a link, you can watch the whole video, trust me, it's good, right? But we ended up starving our bodies for 34 days, and we won. The school reopened this fall with $16 million in new investments for neighborhood children. And it's the first time in this country's in the era of privatization that a closed school was reopened as a neighborhood school. A lot of the things that we want to see in the curriculum are gonna be in the curriculum. Dyett will be a community school. We have a green youth farm there where young people are learning sustainability, and it's a part of their chemistry class. And also, we're doing a lot of worldview development with young people just to infuse the global leadership aspect, because we do not view ourselves as minorities. I hate that term. We view ourselves as part of a global majority. We are global people. There's somebody in Brazil that I'm probably related to. right? But never knew, because when we were snatched from the continent, parts of my family went here, parts of my family went there. So we are a global people. And our young people, oppressed people, are often taught just to know their neighborhood, not to understand that they are part, there's something bigger than them. There's a guy walking down the street in Cuba. If he was in Chicago, his name would be Terrell. He speaks Spanish because the people that stole him spoke Spanish. And so we have to begin to expand our worldview and understand and help our young people understand that we are global people. We're part of a global family. So the fight for Dyett was an example of the type of coalitions that are possible. In the fight for Dyett, Mexican mothers brought us broth every day during the hunger strike. People talk about the black and Mexican divide, but these mothers came from Little Village, and they would bring us broth every day that we can drink because they cared. They loved us, and they watched out for us. White mothers would come and go off on the mayor's staff and make an emotional commitment to this fight. Not a token of commitment, well, I'll come to your press conference and I'll stand with you, but actually stand on the line with us day after day, taking us to the hospital when we got sick, making sure we had things to drink, doing security for us, right? It was to do that for 34 days with 12 people, you can understand the type of network you had to have with you, right? And so we had a support network that watched out for us. After we got weak and we could no longer drive ourselves, they drove us around, right? We slept at Operation Push, Reverend Jesse Jackson's space every night. And people say what they will about Reverend Jesse Jackson, but we went to a lot of these New Age ministers. We went to a lot of churches and asked for that space, and all of them said no. The only place that said yes was Reverend Jackson. So I give him respect, a lot of respect for that effort and kind of being open to that. But it was an example of the type of coalitions that are possible, that we can unify with each other, and other people don't have to shrink to be in the room. It is not a personal assault to say that we are racist, that white brothers and sisters have to struggle with racism. I have a quote, and I'm going to amend it because I'm in a professional space. But I say that I wake up a Negro every morning, and I struggle to be a black man, and it's a difference. I wake up the product of racism every day. Same bad habits, same self-hate, self-doubt, and I struggle against it. I struggle to think like Marcus Garvey. I struggle to think like Shaka. I struggle every day. It is a constant struggle because the assault on our humanity by this system is consistent and it is strong. Every song is played on the radio. Everything that our people see in our communities teach us we can't win. You have households when you tell young people to get a job and they don't even know what you're talking about. You go to a fourth grade classroom and you ask young people, how many of y'all know somebody's been shot? And they all raise their hand. All of them. So we believe, being solution bearing, that in this era of Donald Trump, we have to be in power building mode. We have to challenge the Democratic Party to truly represent, if that's the side that you're rolling with, or the Republican Party as well, to truly represent the needs of people on the ground. We can no longer accept them with this lukewarm agenda that ignores millions of people. And we have to build local power in our communities. So Journey for Justice, you just heard a Chicago story, but there's stories in Philadelphia with the assault at Benjamin Franklin High School, young people organizing to hold police officers in the system accountable. There's stories in New York where organizers forced Mayor de Blasio to open 134 community schools. That was a grassroots initiative. In Camden, New Jersey, one of the most forgotten cities in the United States, they have a charter-free zone. Well, parents have said, we want a K-12 system of education in our neighborhoods. So what I would offer to you brothers and sisters here is to get to know the education justice movement, because there is a movement brewing. People are fighting back in Detroit. There's a network of freedom schools that are happening every Saturday all over Detroit. They fired two emergency managers because the people are rejecting them, because there's a common denominator in all these cities where privatization is happening. And this is our lived experience, so I'm just asking y'all to be patient with your ears and with your hearts. But understand that in all these cities that I'm talking to you about, they took away our right to vote. So school boards can raise our taxes. In Chicago, they can raise our taxes. In New Orleans, they can raise their taxes and the people can't vote them out. So if that's a pimp if I ever knew one. That's pimping if I'm sorry. That's pimping if I ever knew it, where you just gonna take my tax money, you just gonna take my tax dollars, give me mediocre schools, not let my children in because my children are English language learners, not let my son in because my son has special ed, then go to the school district, present to them like you got these fantastic schools, but you can pick who you want and kick out who you don't. My son now has to catch a bus. He has to stand at a bus stop at 5. I'm talking about New Orleans. He has to stand at a bus stop at 5 in the morning. Right? School bus don't come to his house. He has to walk to a major street, stand on a bus stop at 5 in the morning, catch a bus all the way across town to go to a school because the school within walking distance of his home won't take him. That's gangster to do that to somebody. So we are organizing in these cities. There is an education justice fight back. But to be honest with you, I think that my challenge to this room is how do we coalition with each other from an honest space? Because what I'm saying to you, I'm not saying to you in hostility. But I will not sacrifice our truth in order to sit at somebody's table. I won't. When I wake up every day, I got the memories of young people that are gone in my head. I have the women that passed out at school board meetings saying at Stagg Elementary, please don't close my school. If you make my son walk this way, he may not make it. She passes out. They just drag out and they keep going with business. I refuse to co-sign that anymore. I refuse to and we, as the Journey for Justice Alliance, refused to co-sign that. So, just like we whipped the mayor's butt on Dyett High School, just like we've fought and won a trauma center on the south side of Chicago and we beat the University of Chicago, regular people can win. So I'm not here jawjacking with you. I've been a part of major grassroots organizing victories. What we must do is create our own alternative spaces. So if I'm working with this brother, he ain't no nigga when I'm talking to him. He a giant. We create a different space from our narrative, from our lens, from our perspective. And that's how we begin to build the type of system that we want. You must understand that white supremacy is an infection, and we have all been infected. We have all been infected. So, with the time I have left on this planet, my commitment is to leave the next generation an infrastructure. I don't want the next group of organizers to have to start from ground zero. Where is the infrastructure? Where are the relationships? Where are the policymakers? Where are the grassroots principles? I'm talking about school principals. Where are they developed at? Where are the teachers developed that look like my children? Where do they get to? We got a lot of work to do because the privatization movement has infrastructure. Would you agree? They have infrastructure. They have ALEC, who makes their policy, right? They have new leaders, they have the Eli Broad Institute, where they produce superintendents who are privatizers. That's where your Michelle Rees and your Barbara Bird Bennett and all those people come from. They have Teach for America. No offense to anybody here from Teach for America, but they have TFAs, where they develop primarily young white teachers to go into urban spaces. So what happens? There's a school in Detroit, 99% black school, 2 black teachers in the building. So what are we teaching our children? We're teaching our children that we're not fit to lead. That's a dangerous lesson. We've adopted the rhetoric of teacher quality. We've adopted the rhetoric, like we have a teaching problem in the United States. Like the teachers who were veteran teachers who were pushed out of schools, who were told to retire early so that you can make the way for privatization. Like those weren't great teachers. My lived experience training teachers, working with teachers, is that we had great teachers in our community. But all over the United States, a crisis that we are seeing is the attack on black and brown teachers. Massive decreases in the number of those teachers in schools. The only way to defeat that is to have an organized response saying what we want to see, our vision. And the last thing I'll say is that I'm not just saying black and brown people's agenda and other folks' agenda is not respected. I'll give you an example. We work with a group in Chicago called Raise Your Hand. Raise Your Hand has been a leader in the opt-out movement, opting out of standardized tests. They approached us about our people opting out of tests. So we told them, well, we have to make this make sense to our base. So we took their campaign and we messaged it for our people. We talked about standardized tests being used to historically to validate other people's inferiority. And if W.E.B. Du Bois in 1940 had an analysis of standardized tests based on eugenics, saying that it's trying to prove the superiority of whites over blacks. So if he understood that in 1940, why don't we understand that in 2016? As a result, we had two schools in our neighborhood opt out, right? So we are part of the opt-out movement. So we can support each other, but we can't shrink in order to be accepted. And in the progressive movement, we have to understand our tragic flaw, brothers and sisters. We have to. Because Donald Trump ain't the problem. Mike Pence is the problem. No, I'm not joking. What state has the largest number of white supremacist organizations in the United States? Indiana. Why? Because they got cover. They have cover. Look at who he's surrounding himself with and what type of policies. What does that mean for women? What does that mean for brothers and sisters that are Mexican or like or other Latino groups? What does that mean for any immigrant? What does that mean for black people? So we have to build local power so we can fortify our cities against those attacks. Now, this might sound outlandish to you. Well, how are we going to build local power? So I'm going to say it like this. If you go into it thinking you can't do it, you might as well not do it, right? One thing I learned as an organizer is we have to be bold and daring, and we have to push possibilities to the limit, because our only limitations are the ones we accept. Our only limitations are the ones we accept. And the person that I suggest that we study is the late, great Mother Ella Baker. See, we have not learned Ella Baker's lessons. Ella Baker died in 1982, I believe. Ella Baker was the organizer that helped create SNCC. She was the organizer that trained the young people. She recruited Dr. Martin Luther King. And she was ostracized in the civil rights movement because she talked about we should not have a paternalistic attitude towards poor people. Every person, regardless of their income or education level, is fully capable of articulating and organizing to change their reality. To think because of whatever education we have in this system that better qualifies us to have a voice is elitist. And we haven't learned her lesson. She was ostracized in the civil rights movement because she told them to stop the hero worship. It's not about some individual that we're promoting as leaders. Those people in the Montgomery Improvement Association and the Highlander Center, those are the leaders. And her quote was, strong people don't need no leaders. And so I'm honored that y'all asked me to be here. I hope that this message was worth your while. And y'all like, that dude was crazy y'all had come up. But I appreciate your time, and I'm available for any questions or comments or anything like that. Thank you. I take any love I can get. Thank you. Shoot. All right. And all that I say is in the hope of regular people organizing to build a better world. So again, you know, I appreciate y'all. Any questions or comments? Or
we have about 5 minutes for questions, so go ahead and get them in quick, okay? So, because we want to hear from you, and I know I've been following along on the hashtag. There's been a lot of dialogue on Twitter about Jitu's remarks. So if y'all have some questions, come on up, don't be shy. There are no wrong questions.
How do we
10 minutes, we'll give you
10 minutes. Oh, bless you.
How do you begin to unify in a country that's prone to labeling and sorting individuals into categories?
Ask that one more time, I'm sorry.
How do you begin to unify a people that in a country that's prone to labeling and sorting individuals? Progressives,
Teach.
Democrats, Republicans, A
Teach.
Schools, B schools, F schools. Failing schools?
I think we begin to unify the country by building local examples. And those local examples begin to network. So the Journey for Justice Alliance has had some impact because even though we're from different cities, even though some of us are Puerto Rican, some of us are black, some of us are white, we've unified around this platform and then unified our voices to pressure power. So think about it like this. You may not have a million people to march on the battlefield, but you got 50,000 that can jump out the trees. You get what I'm saying? I mean, as an organizer, so you have to be very strategic about how you hit your targets. I think that what we tend to do in the progressive movement is we're always on the defensive. You know, we're always reacting to, if say what you will about the right, they're nothing if they're not bold. They're nothing, they don't care if it's true. They'll say it, they'll go for it, right? Now, but we're not on the progressive side. We tend to be very reactionary. So we have to begin to be visionary, articulating a vision. People will work with you if they are a part of building a platform. What we tend to do, I just had a situation with a progressive group where they tried to work with J for J, but they had already baked the cake. They had baked the cake and basically told us we could put sprinkles on it if we want to. And we said, no, we'll refuse the cake. How about that? And not out of hate, we said, you come back when you're ready to come correct. So we have to redefine our relationships, and then we have to build local examples of the type of unity we want to see, like the fight for Dyett, right? Like the fight for Benjamin Franklin, the assault of Benjamin Franklin. That was a black, white, and brown effort in Philadelphia that resulted in the reduction of police in schools and the increase in the number of counselors. And those were students who won that victory, right? So there are local victories. And one of the things that happens in the struggle is we're very isolated. Right, so we don't know what's going on, that people are fighting back in other parts. So we have to actively begin to have people network to learn about those victories so that you get inspiration and a belief that it's possible. But if every step is uphill, if you don't have any sense that you're gonna ever reach the top, then why struggle, if that makes sense? All right, can I take one more? Thank you.
Make your comment then, yeah. He's only taking one more.
Yes, sir.
I got your back.
I just wanna say that I feel like really inspired with everything you said.
All right.
One love, okay. Little bro. Where you from? Me? Yeah, you. Where you from? Huh?
South City.
San Francisco.
Okay. Yes, sir. I appreciate that. Thank you.
All right. I guess I have a two-part question. I'm totally inspired. I'm going to give you a button when you come off of that stage. And I'm really excited about everything you had to say. And something that just kind of stood out to me about what you were talking about is how the high school, with all the youth organizing around what they valued, is named after a man who was an artist. And so I'm curious about how you, and I'm an artist as well, and how you integrate artists into the movement, into the vision of where we're going. And also how we get to learn our histories, because I feel like I didn't even wake up to my identity and the awarenesses I have until I got to graduate school, because the way we're taught in urban high schools, it totally kind of, I don't know, anesthetizes the truth and our histories. And so could speak to those points, I would really love
that. Yes, ma'am. Well, first I would say that all art is political. So it's very important for us to understand either art is an attempt for you to shape the world how you see it, or really a sickly inability to feel the spirit of your ancestors. It's one or the other, right? There is no such thing as art that is apolitical. All art delivers a message. So I think that we have to, as artists, we have to understand that. I understood that as an MC, right? I understood that if I'm on stage and I'm rocking a crowd, what I'm saying matters, right? And so, I think that's one. Two, I think that we have to insist upon culturally relevant curriculum, and curriculum that's engaging with young people's lived experience. Education is supposed to awaken young people's consciousness so that they can move society forward, not to be a spoke in the wheel. Not to be a spoke in the wheel. But we crush young people's spirit. I give you a good example. Who's familiar with the ethnic studies fight in Tucson, Arizona? Right? Now, we know that what those young people and those educators did improved graduation rates. We know that it improved student achievement. But a white school board not willing to let those brothers and sisters as Chicano have their own analysis of what Christopher Columbus and American history means to them, crushed that program. So we have to locally fight for that together. Fight for culturally relevant curriculum. So I believe that that's a major part of it. So like in Journey for Justice, we have a vision we call sustainable community schools. And culturally relevant curriculum is a main component of that. We have five pillars. And I think we have to begin to articulate what good schools mean to us. And art and music is not extracurricular. It's not extracurricular. It should be part of the core curriculum, right? So. Yes, sir.
You said something about like how like impactful music is on our youth, and like I work primarily with youth, and like a lot of the music doesn't represent us well.
Mm-hmm.
And but it's, as a mentor, it's hard for me to like tell them like not to listen to the music, because like I feel like I'm not letting them be themselves.
Yeah.
But like, how do you like get them to like see past the music as just being entertainment, mm-hmm. and not internalizing what those words mean and like those ideologies are? It's mm-hmm. like, how do you get them to see that they don't have to be the next rapper or the next sports player? And it's like,
I got you.
Yeah.
I got you. So I would say this, that, you know, I come from the golden era of hip hop, right? So I come from the KRS-One, Eric B and Rakim, Public Enemy, Big Daddy Kane, MC Light. Those are people that I was on, right? But we also listen to Ice-T, Let's Get Butt Naked, and right?
Yeah. So I'm so right there with you.
I'm not gonna sit here in front like we was the, like we had the beats on wearing halos, talking about peace on earth. And, no, we. So, but what we had was a balance.
Yeah.
What we had was a balance.
A lot so, of balance.
I'm a card player. I love to play cards. And me and my friends would play cards in the basement. And I had friends that were gangster disciples, right? And we sitting there listening to KRS-One. Why is that? Well, he's talking about the black presence in the Bible. Thugs. Talking about, you know, Genesis chapter 11, verse 10. Explains the genealogy of Shem. Shem was a black man in Africa. If you repeat this back, they can't laugh at you. And we actually got politicized by hip-hop, right? So I think exposing young people to independent artists is also another way to do it, right? But don't expose them to independent artists that are huff. They got to be good, right? They got to have some skill. So, but honestly, you know, I've done that with young people, exposing to people like Immortal Technique, right? And folks like that. And then they're like, oh man, oh boy, Cole. And then also walk them through the connections between music and the prison industrial complex. Walk them through how, what does programming mean, right? So when you watch television, and in every black movie, there has to be a white savior, right? When you watch, when you listen to the radio, and there's nothing about what we're going through, but at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, they'll play a song about me blowing somebody's head off, or about how I degrade, or I want this woman to bounce like this and bounce like that, and they'll play that at 3 in the afternoon. But they won't play any records about police brutality. They won't play any records about, you know, privatization. But they, and you know, and so if you begin to help them see those connections, they'll make their own analysis, right? And they're gonna listen to both, right? So I'm very careful not to be the old dude that's just disgruntled, right? So, you know, I hate all of it, right? But that old mess, right? So it's important to let young people listen to what they listen to, but help them with their analysis. And they'll come up with their own conclusions. And it's been my experience that they'll start listening to music that's saying something, or stop listening to so much of stuff, or like, man, why old boy, you know, why is this all he talk about? People develop their own analysis when you open the door, and you get them a little bit, and then you know just process it with them. Yes, sir. But definitely, there are a lot of independent artists that are out here that are nice, right? That young people can get exposed to. Bring those independent artists to your school, right? There's nothing like an MC that can rock a crowd. I don't care what you listen to, like an MC with skills that can get in the room. All he need is the DJ, drum beat, and a mic, right? And because an MC is different than a rapper,
yeah.
Right? An MC is like some people can hold a note, Patti LaBelle can sing, mm-hmm. right? So it's a difference between an MC and a rapper. Right, what's the young dude? Lil Shouty, Lil Howdy, whatever his name is.
Lil Uzi, or Lil Yachty.
Lil Yachty. All right, Lil Yachty. You know, that's a rap dude. That's a rap dude, right? But J. Cole is an MC.
He's an MC.
You get what I'm saying? It's different. He got skills. So, is that it?
Yeah.
All right.